listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper.
And I'm Carolyn Nelson.
Tonight, folks, we've got a little bit of surprise. It was a surprise to me, anyway, when I heard a speech by a young man who lives in New York City that he delivered to a whole class of socialists at a local college in New York. And tonight, I'll tell you, when you hear this speech, folks, you're going to be very pleased. I was so thrilled with what this young man has done and with the courage that it took to walk into this college, as young and inexperienced as he is, and deliver this speech that he researched and wrote himself after having listened for a short time to the Hour of the Time and setting out to find out whether or not we were right. And what do you think he found out, folks? Don't go away.
Oh, beautiful, forsaken sky,
Carolyn, you had a call from a young gentleman. You remember that?
I certainly do. Hello, Bruce.
I had a call from us
in New York, in the New York City area, and we
exchanged ideas about the fact that we both lived in the same place. I lived there for 25 years,
and Bruce is living there now. And he told me he was going to give a talk at a local college, and I recorded it because it just sounded really good. And I think you're going to hear it tonight.
You recorded it. He read it to you before he actually went and did this talk at the college.
Right. He read it Sunday morning to me.
Okay. And then he told you what happened after he read that speech, and that was quite interesting. We're going to get into that a little bit later. Bruce, are you there?
I'm here.
Bruce, welcome to the Hour of the Time. I want to tell you, it's a thrill for me to have you on this program after having heard your speech. You are, my friend, a brilliant speechwriter and an excellent researcher, and not because you've found or confirmed what we've been teaching here, the information that we've been disseminating to the world, so to speak, but simply because you did all of that yourself, and it's not a coincidence that you came up with the same conclusions. What I would like for you to do is tell our audience who you are. You don't have to say your address or your last name if you don't wish to, but tell our audience who you are and how this all came about.
Okay. My name's Bruce Lahadu, and I'm from Long Island, New York. And basically how this all came about is I have a friend who is going to Queens College, and he made a memorandum that I had become a Christian within the past 2 years or so, and
okay, Bruce, I need to ask you to do something, because
yes.
I want everybody out there to hear your story.
Okay.
On radio, especially shortwave, it's a little difficult for people to hear through the static sometimes. So you have to make sure your phone is directly in front of your mouth, and you have to keep the same volume in your voice all the time. It was hard for me to learn that, but you're going to be on here for a while, so let's get it going right off the bat, okay?
Okay.
There you go. Okay, go ahead. Continue.
Okay, so my friend knew that I had some very different ideas of what he was being taught at school, and he also knew that my ideas differed from your from
people that you see on the front of the news page and, you know, wherever else, you know, the media. Media version of who Christians, what Christians are, and so he felt that his, this class that he was in, that he wanted to get some different point of views in that, and he didn't necessarily agree with my point of view, but he wanted to get a different point of view in there.
He didn't like everything being one-sided, is that correct?
That's correct.
And you told me earlier when we talked on the phone, well, why don't you say it in your own words? What were they really doing in this class? What was really the gist of it, the bottom line?
This class is a great example of mind control. He was talking, the day before, one student was to give a oral report. And what he was talking about in his oral report was about how can the world ever, could the world ever come together and become, you know, united? Could there ever be peace on planet Earth? And
the teacher criticized him about
was that he didn't use enough great philosophers. For instance, Freud, and he really got into B.F. Skinner, and he started talking about how B.F. Skinner was this great philosopher, and how he talked about how we're just animals, and that we can be manipulated, and he talked about all these experiments, and I pointed out to the professor that I said, you are aware that there are 100 different psychologies, and that they all contradict, and that is
you mean
science.
You mean philosophies,
right? And also I pointed out that I think that man has a spiritual aspect to us also. And but anyway, you know, it was incredible.
Now, what we talked about earlier, you had indicated to me that really the gist of this class was all of the world's ills can be blamed upon one group of people. And which group is that?
The Christians.
And so the purpose of this class basically was to teach these young children socialism, and if they could just get rid of the Christians, they could have their one world totalitarian utopian government. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. You know, it just amazes me that this is going on in our universities, and parents are sending their children there, and they don't even understand what they're doing. The universities are, in fact, and I know you only know about your little university there, but I've, through the CAGI organization, we have pretty much studied the general gist of the teachings in our university system and the colleges around this country, and it is Marxist socialism, or what they call it in class, democratic socialism, and as if this is going to be the answer to the world's ills. But your friend asked you to come and talk to this class. Did he tell you what he wanted you to talk about?
Not exactly. He just told me that that they talk about these type of topics in his term, but that they had shown Jerry Falwell film, and they talked about the Christian correlation a lot. And he mentioned that Christians did not get they weren't held in a good light in this class. And
did they talk about separation of church and state and issues?
Which, by the way, folks, there is no such thing. That's not in the Constitution.
Or
something that they've invented. The Constitution, in fact, prohibits the state from interfering with religion. And that's really what it's all about. Go ahead, Bruce.
Yeah, so that's really what they talk about in that class. And what the class is a class to teach young students to become teachers. And that's all they talked about. When I was in the class, I couldn't believe the propaganda that was being talked about.
You mean there was no objectivity?
No.
They weren't presenting.
The teacher had total control over the it was made to be, you know, the teacher would bring up a topic, and he would control the way
the way the conversation would go in the class.
Okay. And
anyone who didn't agree with him, you know, he would shut him right up. And just, you know, go on with his ideas.
And of course those people don't get good grades, do they?
They I don't know what grades or what.
So the people who
disagree with the professor.
I would guess not.
That's a good guess, Bruce. Listen, have you got your speech there?
Yes, I do.
You know, there's a lot of people out there in this world that need to hear what you're going to say. How old are you?
I'm 30 years old.
You're 30 years old. A lot of people out there in the world need to hear what you're going to tell them right now. Now, Bruce, I'm 50 years old. Took me most of my life to realize that I was a stupid idiot. And then once I got out of that, I became a sheeple. And then once I began to study and learn, I finally became a real people. And you've got such a jump on everybody that it's pathetic. When I was 30 years old, I was still chasing women around the flagpole. So I've got to give you an awful lot of credit, my friend. If you would, could you please read your speech to the world and do it in a loud, clear voice. And by golly, be proud of those words. I've listened to them, folks. And if you get anything out of what this young man is going to say right now, anywhere near what I got out of it, then this whole night has been a tremendous success. It's all yours, Bruce. You have the world.
Okay, thank you, William Cooper. Okay, I would like to thank my friend Jack for inviting me to share my viewpoint with you. He does not know what I'm going to say, and he may or may not agree with me. I am here to represent myself. I do not represent any group, organization, or religion. Although I do fellowship with people with similar beliefs, they neither represent me, nor do I represent them. I am a free soul, and I speak for myself. Post-Cold War and the New Quiet War. I believe the next war has already begun, and the enemy is already crying victory. Who is the enemy? The enemy is elusive. They are not the Russians or the Japanese. They are not the Germans or the Jews. They are not the Muslims or the Catholics, the Protestants, the Hindus, New Agers, or even the Satan worshippers per se. They are not our enemy because for every freedom-loving American citizen who believes in our Constitution and Bill of Rights believes strongly in the separation of church and state, that every man has the right to exercise his religion and practice free speech. Our enemy do not believe in separation of church and state, and believe their religion to be the only true religion, and believe themselves to be of a superior race. The fact they believe their religion to be the one true religion does not make them the enemy. I believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven. The Catholics believe there's no salvation outside our church. The Muslim believes Allah is the one true God, and the Hindus have their gods. But that is not what makes them our enemy. They are, I believe, because they have not been upfront with us with what they believe and how that affects the rest of us. Many of them profess to be one religion, when in all reality, in poor conscience, they know they are telling a lie. They are conspirators who want control over the whole world. They are the men of the secret societies. They are a group of men who believe themselves to be of a higher order. Further along the evolutionary path to godhood than the rest of us. They are the members of a secret brotherhood known as the Illuminati, which is the innermost core to this beehive of deception. They are the taproot of many branches of secret societies. Religious organizations and political organizations all working towards a common goal. Novus Ordo Seculum. A new world order. They come from all walks of life and different religious backgrounds, but they all belong to a common religion, which most of them don't understand, but think they do. They have been deliberately deceived from those above them. It is a mystery religion in the shape of a pyramid and has its roots way back in the distant past. It is a religion of the esoteric and the profane. It's about coming from darkness to light and is fundamentally racist and prescribes to the Aryan race theory. And yes, Lucifer was the first Illuminist. He is the god of the material world
the architect of the universe, the son of the morning, the fallen star represented as the sun god, and the serpent, the symbol of wisdom. Some of you may be saying to yourselves, well, I don't believe in that stuff, but that really doesn't matter, because the point is they do, and they are more powerful than you could ever imagine. They are the hidden government, the international bankers, and many, many organizations you know nothing about. They have been telling us through the controlled media that we must forget all our differences and come together under one banner. And that is our only hope for planetary survival. And soon they will tell us we must, or else, enter into their one-world utopia. There will be no thievery, because we will be a cashless society, with a microchip implant under our skin, and will be closely monitored from the cradle to the grave. No more violent crimes, because they will have all the guns. Overpopulation? Don't worry, Big Brother's got it all under control. You won't have to think, and you won't have to be responsible. Big Brother will take care of you. Folks, don't be fooled. Things aren't always the way they seem to be. Remember, the brainwashed do not know they are brainwashed. And how do they brainwash us? By calling socialism democracy. By calling the truth a lie, and the lie the truth. By saying good is evil, and evil is good. They control the media and the politicians. Yes, they play both sides at the bottom. At the bottom, they seem to be against each other. But at the top, all these organizations are the same. They are neither conservative or liberal. They are liars and masters of deceit. Their aim is to pit one group of society against another, and have been behind every revolution and war, religious and otherwise. The high priests of this religion practice ordo ad cao, and they must destroy the old order before installing the new order. There will be the phoenix bird that rises out of the ashes, out of chaos to become order, the new world order. They promote homosexual lifestyle on one hand, while the other hand has targeted them for extermination, i.e. AIDS, the new Inquisition. They help those who sell guns and drugs to promote gang violence on one hand, so they can take away our Second Amendment rights to bear arms, to counterbalance the power, and to protect us from a totalitarian government. They enforce a perverted and unconstitutional version of separation of church and state, outlawing all religion save their own. There is no separation of church and state with them, and they control our educational system. To most of you, you probably think I'm totally out of my mind, and you don't know what I'm talking about, that I don't know what I'm talking about. You think I'm paranoid. Well, I wish it were true, but facts are facts, whether you are aware of them or not. There is a conspiracy in this country, in the world, to manipulate world events in such a way that there are no sovereign states or countries. They want us to be their slaves in a new world order with a few extremely wealthy elite at the top while we live under socialism on the bottom. But you must do your own research. Don't take my word for it. I could be lying. I'm not saying I am. I'm saying listen to everyone, but believe no one. There's a lot of disinformation out there. If you want the truth, you must get off your asses and search it out. They're not going to give it to you on Larry King Live. I want to be right out front with you. My mission in life is to seek out truth, whatever that may be. The truth that I speak about, however, is not the laws of physics or why E equals MC squared, but to answer the age-old question, why am I here, and what is my destiny, and the destiny of all mankind? These questions, in my opinion, are the only questions worth asking. I cannot prove that God exists, or that Jesus is God scientifically, but there are many things that are true that can't be proven scientifically. Jesus, contrary to popular belief, was very much opposed to religion. He came to set men free from religion. Jesus told the woman at the well that the hour cometh that you will neither worship me in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem, but the hour cometh, and now is when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Jesus condemned the religious leaders of his day when he said, but woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves.
that many grievous wolves would enter in unawares, not sparing the flock, and that they would pervert the gospel. Jesus even said, "Not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Many will say in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, and in your name cast out devils, and in thy name do wonderful works? And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." The point is this: if they proclaim to be Christian, let them emulate Christ when he said, "I spake openly to the world, and in secret have I said nothing." Jesus came to call people out of this world, and so do his followers that worship him in truth. I am here to warn you of the inevitable. The plan for a one-world government and a world religion will someday be a reality. I think very soon. As for me, I believe it is my duty to speak the truth as I see it, and I can only speak for myself. I am not for this new world order because I don't think it will bring real peace. I believe imperfect man is incapable of ruling imperfect man, whoever they may be, Christian or otherwise. It will not work. In fact, it will be the worst disaster the world has ever seen since its conception. I believe there will be peace on earth when the Prince of Peace comes again. So it is not up to man, but God, and not some race of God men, Christian or otherwise. That does not mean I don't care about the environment or my fellow man, because I do. I believe it is my duty as a God-fearing American citizen to stand up and even die if I must for the freedom, justice, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for all mankind. And when I hear people saying, "Oh, it's not my fault," or "I'm not responsible," and emulating the pop star Billy Joel when he sings, "We didn't start the fire," I say, we need to wake up. These are the words of an oppressed people. Wake up, stand up, and let's get our country back before it really is too late.
Thank you, Bruce. I spoke openly and in secret, have I said nothing. If you belong to one of these secret societies or mystery schools, you better take that to heart. I spake openly, and in secret have I said nothing. There is no reason in this world for anyone to meet in secret for any reason unless they are doing something that would not be approved of by their neighbors or the community at large. Bruce, what happened when you gave that talk?
Right after that talk, I was gonna play a segment from your show, and so I turned on the tape recorder, and I had some papers to hand out, and I started handing them out, and so I got to hand out all my papers, and as soon as I handed out the papers, the professor told me to turn off the tape.
What was I talking about on that tape?
You were talking about the 10 points of the Communist Manifesto and how, we're pretty much living under the Communist Manifesto now.
And, do you think the professor sort of felt that he was being outed in front of his students?
Most definitely.
What happened?
Well, he told me to turn it off. He said, we really got to talk about this, and, everybody in the room was pretty shocked. They were looking at the papers I had given out, and one of the papers that I gave out talks about censorship in your school. Should creationism be taught? Shouldn't all ideas be expressed? And I wrote down, evolution and creation are both only theory. Neither can be proven by science nor disproven. Both ideas can be found in religious schools of thought. Creationism is believed by many Bible-believing Christians and Jews, Muslims, maybe, I don't know. Evolutionism is believed by all who belong to the mystery religions, Rosicrucians, Masons, etc. Also, it is the first tenet of humanism, which is a non-profit religious organization. Believe me, look it up in the Humanist Manifesto, 1933.
So you've really done your homework, haven't you?
Yes. And did you know that according to an AP NBC news poll,
86% of the American people believe that creationism should be taught alongside evolution, and lawyers, 2-1, thought it was unconstitutional not to have it taught alongside evolution. And Karl Marx dedicated his book, Das Kapital, to Darwin, who gave credibility to his theory of socialism. Hitler, the head of the National Socialist Party, believed fervently in the survival of the fittest evolution. And John Dewey, who formed modern education, was a humanist and a socialist. And one of the students in the class challenged me on that. And he said, he's like looking at these papers, and he was really giving me an evil look. And he goes, you gotta be kidding me, this is ridiculous. Creationism should be taught in school. And the teacher was agreeing with him. I said, well, you go ahead and prove it. You know, I want you to prove your theory of evolution. I don't see no half cat, half some other animal. Where's your in between species? And it really upset them, because they really didn't have any proof. And the professor was just he was telling me, I'm gonna prove you wrong. And how he tried to prove me wrong, he was talking about Jim Jones, the Moonies. He was talking about the Children of God. He was attacking my character, and he told me, where'd you get all this information? And I told him some of the books, and he goes, well, what are the publishers? You know, there are some good publishers out there, and there are some phony publishers. So it really caused a stir. And
You see how they work this, folks? When they couldn't address the facts, when they couldn't prove this young man wrong, when they couldn't even argue with what he had said in any intelligent manner, first they attacked his character, and then they didn't attack the information as being true or false. They attacked the publisher as not being a good publisher. In other words, I guess if you printed the Webster's Dictionary, or let's take the number one authority for English in the world. If you took the Oxford Dictionary and published it in some unknown little press down in Arkansas somewhere, then the information in there would be no good. Is that what they're trying to tell you, Bruce?
I guess so, yeah.
That is a typical socialist response to being cornered and not having any facts to refute or to present any argument whatsoever. Instead of having a dialogue, an exchange of ideas, presenting their facts and letting them stand or fall, what do they do? They attack your character. How could they attack your character, Bruce, when they didn't even know you?
I don't know. And some of the kids pointed that out, too. And one of the things that the professor was saying was, you come in here and you give this speech and you ain't got no proof to back this up. And this is after I handed out eight pages of different books with the publishing house.
Mm-hmm.
A thing by Tex Mars, which has pictures of all these Masonic symbols.
Yeah.
And
okay, hold on, Bruce. I hate to interrupt you. We've got to take a short break. Don't go away.
Okay.
Socialism sucks. Socialism has always sucked, and socialism always will suck. Everywhere it's ever been attempted in this world, it has failed miserably. People have been thrown into prison camps, concentration camps. People have been murdered by the millions. under socialism. It is ironic that the people who first promote socialism and do the most to bring it about are what is called the intelligentsia. The college professors, the scientists, the philosophers, all of these people who go to school for many, many years and for some reason think they're so smart, and at the same time forgot to look back at history and see what the real facts are. And they don't bother to understand that the first people that are destroyed when socialism comes to power are the same people who brought it about, the intelligentsia. Now, if you don't believe that, and if you're one of these fools who are helping to bring it about, thinking that you're going to be one of the rulers and that all of the hardships and the misery and the labor camps and the death won't touch you, I challenge you to look at history, because you will be first, my friend. You will be first. You'd better listen to what this young man is telling you tonight. And Bruce, why don't you continue with your story about what happened after you gave this talk at the university?
Okay. Well, he was attacking my character, and also he was saying that, you know, who are you to come in here with, you know, just give this speech and not have anything to back it up. And I had like 5 books with me. Like I said, I handed out these sheets, and someone in the audience pointed out that he talks all the time without having backing what he says up with facts all the time. He talks all the time like that. So I thought that was nice to hear somebody defend me. And
in fact, most college professors don't back up what they say with facts, especially in philosophical or psychology classes and things like this. They expound their opinion and their viewpoint and expect the students to go along with it 100%. They do have reading lists and study guides and things like that in some of those classes, but many classes have no structure whatsoever.
Exactly. And all those, you know, philosophies and psychologies, none of those can be proven by science.
Absolutely not. Psychology is not a science at all, and philosophy is subject to argument, is subject to debate. None of it can be scientifically proven. In fact, science is science. It can be proven or disproven by the scientific method, and many scientists will tell you that that is not valid in some instances. Religion is based upon an article of faith, and so is not even subject to debate or argument. Can be discussed as a matter of particular points, differentiations between religions, and philosophy, of course, is open to debate always, and they've never come up with a philosophy that fits all peoples for all times, or that could be said to be true in all instances all the time, or even in one instance some of the time. So what I'm trying to say is there's a definite split between these, and when they preach this dogma of Marxist socialism, they're preaching it as if it's absolute fact and it's going to be the cure to the ills of the world.
Truth.
What do you think it's going to do, Bruce?
I think it's going to be the demise of the world.
And I think you're absolutely right. Now, you didn't get that from me. How did you come about that? How did you derive that that feeling?
Well, for me, it came from studying the Bible. I've only heard about your show since October. So
you've only been listening for a short time.
Yes, yes. And how this all came about was, for me, was my girlfriend at the time, when married now, was trying to convert me to Christian Science, and at that time I was brought up a Catholic, and what she was saying didn't make sense. And then she had a friend who was into spirit guides, and we kept on meeting these people who were into, you know, like contacting UFOs, you know, all this weird stuff, and it made me think, you know, what really is going on in the world. And I just made a decision that I wanted to
find out what the truth was. If there was a truth, I was gonna, you know, I wanted to go and seek that. And it started by reading the Bible, and then from there I started reading books on prophecy, and that's how I heard about Tex Morris. And then I got a shortwave radio to listen to his program, and then I one dead night I was flipping around and I listened to your show, and I was pretty much amazed. I was like, this guy's really hitting it on the money. And it was a real pleasure to find a voice out there in the wilderness. You know, there are a few voices out there that are getting out the truth. It's very difficult to find too many voices out there, and there's hardly anybody. It's very hard to find anybody who wants to even consider a different opinion. I call up all my friends, ever since I've been into this and found the truth, as much of it as we know, I've been trying to inform my friends, you know, relatives, everybody I know, and people are just very reluctant to even speak that there could be another point of view to what's going on in the world. And I don't know why that is, really. I really don't understand that personally.
Well, I understand it a little bit, but once people's eyes begin to be opened, then I don't understand why they would willingly march into slavery when they've been forewarned. That bothers me an awful lot. But when I look back through history, I see that it's always happened throughout history. The people have always done what they were told to do. They have marched wherever they've been told to march. They've gone to the executioner whenever they've been told to go to the executioner. Sometimes in history, a minority have risen up and overthrown the tyrants, and even that's very risky because you never know who's going to come out with the power, and they could be worse than the one that was overthrown. So what I'm trying to do here is wake people up so that we can make the changes we need to make bloodlessly, within the law, and in a manner that we can all be proud of. So I want to thank you, Bruce, for being a guest on the show.
My pleasure.
I want to thank you so much for having the brain and using it, and for having the guts to go in the den of the lion and cut his tail off right in front of his class.
Well, it felt real good. It felt. I was scared as hell to go in there.
I bet you were. I got to tell you, every time I went up the river in Vietnam, I was scared too. But I went up that river.
It felt good. It felt good to get it off my chest.
That's right.
You know, it really felt good to... I'm just going to say what... You know, I have a right to speak my mind.
You sure do.
I went in there and I spoke my mind. And it shook him up. It shook him up, I'll tell you.
I wish I could have seen it. I want to thank you for being a guest on the show, Bruce. I know you've got a copy of that speech on the way to us. We'll send you a copy, a tape of this program for your records. And I'm gonna get in touch with you because a brain like yours shouldn't be wasted. How would you like to have an honorable membership in KJ?
Oh, that'd be great.
You got it, my friend. Okay. Good night.
All right. Good night.
Thank you.
Folks, we're going to take some calls now till the end of the hour. It's 602-333-2174. Carolyn, I know you wanted to... say something. I think you did.
Well, I should have forced my way in, I guess. I wanted to ask Bruce about his handler. He gave out some interesting papers. I know the one on the secret weapons and secret wars was one of them. And
quiet weapons. Silent weapons for quiet wars, yeah. Yeah, that's chapter one in my book.
And right offhand, I can't remember the other ones, but he had 8 or 9 pages there, and I'm sure people are going to be reflecting on everything that he said, and it'll be interesting to see the follow-up.
Yes, it will.
Hello, Bill. I just got back from New York. I was on Manhattan.
I need you to talk a lot louder, my friend.
Well, I went to New York. I just got back, and I went to visit the United Nations.
Uh-huh.
And I tried to get in to see the meditation room,
uh-huh.
But it's been closed. And when I inquired why it's been closed, the woman told me that about 10 years ago somebody tried to blow it up.
That's baloney, because it was open as little as 2 months ago.
Oh, really? Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's interesting. Wow. And so so that's closed, and they wouldn't let anybody in there. But next to the meditation room is a big stained glass window.
Uh-huh.
And it's the sort of a dominant blue stained glass window with strange motifs in it. It was donated by some Italian artist or a Dutch artist to the UN. I'm not sure. I think it was sometime in the 60s it was donated. And these Sartre motifs inside of these goat men.
Yeah.
Inside the window, and there's actual, the goat motif in it is incredibly dominant. I counted the numbers of the goats inside of it, and there's about 7 or 8.
The goat of Mimbay.
That's right, yeah. There's also a serpent in it, and also there's a crucifixion scene in the upper right-hand corner.
Uh-huh.
And they show, you know, the Christ being crucified, and they show the people watching it, and everybody's laughing, you know, as they're watching it. But it seemed as if they were laughing, not in the sense of it being historically accurate, as it happened.
Well, that's true. They're mocking.
They're mocking it, yeah.
Mocking Christianity.
And then
the goats are running around to show you who they're really in support of.
That's exactly what it was.
And there were goats and little kids, right?
There were a few, little children running around in there, yeah. And then above the cross is a red goat, a little red goat with a smile on its face.
Yeah, big smile.
And, so that was, you know, I saw that and took some pictures of that. Also, they have a moon rock in the UN, and guess what? The moon rock is embedded inside of a plasticine pyramid.
How about that? Don't you think it's funny, folks, that the pyramids in Egypt were used as temples of initiation, and all of a sudden, they're presenting us with photographs, which we can't verify because we can't go to Mars and telling us that there's pyramids on Mars. They are in the official NASA photographs. I can tell you that, folks, but are those photographs genuine? I don't know. But I think it's pretty fishy that they're pyramids.
Yeah, it's quite strange. I mean, I look at that, and I know something about the hermetic, the alchemical processes, and the whole agenda of the hermetic school. And so wouldn't that be the successful operation of bringing prima materia back to prima terra?
That's correct.
Yeah, they've used it, both of them inside of each other, and it's on display there for everybody to see.
Sure, and they've brought the temples back to temples of initiation in Las Vegas, where they're initiating the sheeple into the new one-world religion without them even realizing what they're a part of there.
Right.
Listen, our time is short, so we got to go. I want to thank you for calling.
Thank you.
602-333-2174. Try to get as many callers in here as we can. Good evening, you're on the air.
Yeah, Bill, I have a question for you. What do you think of Don McElvaney?
Don McElvaney was an employee, an agent of the Central Intelligence Agency, and you've heard what I said before. There are no ex-intelligence agents. I should say officers.
Yeah.
There are no ex-intelligence officers. Officers are officers for life, forever.
So you think he's still in it?
Well, all I can tell you is what I know.
Yeah, yeah. And then I've also heard of Maurice Strong.
Yeah?
Canadian. Building a temple here up here in
Colorado.
Yeah, where is that going on?
San Jose Valley, I believe.
San Juan Valley. I may go swim by and see that. But keep up the good work, all right? I love your show.
Thank you, sir.
God bless.
602-333-2174. Maurice Strong is really into all this. They've built a little religious center there with a dome. They even have a receptacle in which to place the Holy Grail when they find it. If they find it. Good evening, you're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. Cooper. I've been listening to you for quite some time now, and I was trying to get a hold of you this afternoon to see about getting some information packets to join your organization.
Memberships are on hold, but that young man has done such a good job that I'm going to make him a member. We're not accepting any more applications for CAGI membership at this time.
One more question for you, then. I was interested in whether or not you had seen the show Sequest on NBC. It airs at 8 o'clock on Sunday night. And this is a show that has men and women pretty much dressed in the same uniform. It's a futuristic show. And last week's episode, of course, featured talk about the new United Nations tribunal and a world government that was taking, you know, that was running the world at this particular time. It was, I guess, in the early 21st century, and Roy Scheider is the spirit.
Yeah, it's all part of the education of the sheeple.
It is absolutely incredible. I've been a member of a conservative group for a number of years, and I just started tuning in on the short wave in the last few months, and they're doing a hell of a job out there. We appreciate it. I'm in New Hampshire, by the way, so we're quite a ways away, but we appreciate your efforts.
Could you guys hear last night's show?
No, I tell you, the tape was a little fuzzy, but the parts of the tape that were important, I think at least for me, I was in my car on the way home from work,
mm-hmm.
and I was able to get enough of the speech, of course, to get the feeling of it. And your implication, at least to me, was clear that, you know, in order for the New World Order to get installed, the officer corps of the military have to at least not resist or not resist wholeheartedly.
That's right.
And your message was clear that it's unthinkable that such so much pride and so much honor could be undermined in the way that it has in the last 30 years. You know, it's just a systematic destruction of the military. I have a brother-in-law that serve, and he's told me that through the socialization of the affirmative action programs within the services, that the lower order officers, you know, they've promoted people through affirmative action that are not as quality of people as they would have got otherwise, and it has resulted in, you know, in a dumbing down of the military, especially in ranks like master sergeant and nose ranks, not corps officers, but lower grade.
Yeah, and this has nothing to do with race, what he's talking about.
Absolutely not. I mean, of course, that through affirmative action, the socialists have in all of our society, have found ways to, you know, they utilize affirmative action as a tool to create friction between the races, and as a result of that, and then they also utilize it to authorize not putting the best people into the jobs.
That's right, and they put people in positions that they're not able to handle because they don't have the education to handle. They're from sometimes the inner city. They have not had the educational opportunities that maybe someone else had, and just because they are of a certain race, they are put into a position that ultimately they can't handle. It's not fair to them. It's not fair to the country. It's not fair to anyone else.
Absolutely. And again, it's just another tool that the New World Order crowd is using to turn our society against itself, and we all should be uniting and fighting against them.
That's correct.
Do you think you might open up cadre memberships
again in the future? Well, if we do, it's going to be completely revamped, and if anybody wants press credentials, it's going to cost them $100. People have caused us more pain over these press credentials than anything else. We put that together hoping that people could use those so that they could get into places where they could get members of access to, and use that to gather information and further their education. We have some people that are just flat stolen the press credentials. We have people who have mutilated them, and then they go in and try to use them, and because they're mutilated, they can't use them, so they send back and want us to give them a duplicate card. And we have people who misuse the press credentials, and that's one of the biggest problems. And so we're just completely revamping this thing. Even amongst the CAGI members, there's a certain percentage of people who, although that they would like to claim that they're real people, are still sheeple. Most of the CAGI members are brilliant, exceptional people who really work hard to dig out information and to help.
This has become clear from listening to your shows. When I first listened to you, I wasn't sure. I'm a member of another conservative group, and I was aware of a conspiracy and believed in a conspiracy for a number of years. And I wasn't quite sure about the nature of the suggestion of the Masonic orders, and I had heard of the Illuminati, and the more reading I've done and the more I've looked around me, the more I've become convinced that your research is accurate. And that's why, over the past several months of listening, I've just become more and more convinced I was going to call for your mystery tapes and try and get them,
That brings up a good thing. If you want the mystery tapes, you better get them now, because just for Christmas, to try to help everybody out and try to get these into as many hands as possible, we brought it down for CAGI members. They're $100 for the complete set. For non-CAGI members, $150. That's
over $100 off for everybody.
And if it's the same number during the day, we can make that order, right?
Yeah, 602, well, we don't take orders over the phone. You'll have to send your money.
Yeah, sure.
A check, money order, or cash if you want to take that risk.
Maybe I'll hang up and you can give the address once again.
Okay.
I appreciate it, Bill.
Thank you for calling.
Have a nice evening from New Hampshire.
You too.
Thank you.
Okay, folks, if you want to buy the complete set of the Mystery School series, send, if you're a CAGI member, $100. If you're a non-CAGI member, $150 to William Cooper, P.O. Box 1420. Sholo, spelled S-H-O-W-L-O-W, Arizona, 85901. That's P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. One more time, and then I'll give you a phone number that you can call and talk about. We have other things that we've severely discounted just for Christmas, and we're not going to do it again. So it's P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. A phone number to call if you want to talk about the other things that we have available at severely discounted price up until December the 20th. Anything postmarked after December the 20th will not be honored. Understand that, folks. And we're working every day to get all the orders out that come in every day to get them out the next day. And we're doing really good. I've got to tell you, I'm surprised at how well we're doing because there's not many of us here to do it. You can call 602-333-5174. That's 602-333-5174. One more time for the slow folks. 602-333-5174. Time's up, folks. I want to thank you for being such a good little herd of sheeple out there. Good night, and God bless you all. Joking, of course.
Tomorrow, good day. All the things were gone. God save us all. And I had to start again. It's just my children and my wife. Thank my lessons for
Bill Cooper. Why don't you write today? Write to CAGI, spelled C-A-J-I, Box 1420, Sholo, spelled at S-H-O-W-L-O-W, Arizona, 85901. Again, CAGI, Box 1420, Sholo, AZ, 85901, USA. Of course, you can call the Research Center. That number is 602-333-5174. Again, 602-333-5174. And of course, listen for the Hour of the Time with Bill Cooper right here on WWCR.